Good news first, EIP 1559 is live and the Ethereum network has already burned a couple of thousand ETH. Well, that happened fast. We'll tell you everything you need to know about EIP 1559 and how it could affect the price of ETH in just a second. But first, a bit of bad news. The United States government is trying to force through some last-minute crypto legislation that could have long-lasting impact on how blockchain technology is regulated in the US. We'll get you filled in on what's happening and why this particular piece of legislation could be a game changer. Hang out with us for a few minutes as we bring you up to speed on this week's Exodus Crypto News. Thanks for joining us, everybody. I'm Chris Merkel, and if you would be so kind, please smash that like button and subscribe to the channel for more crypto videos from Exodus coming at you every week. Ethereum's EIP 1559 just went live a day ago, and this is definitely one of the biggest stories we've seen in crypto in a long time. Leah Hilpern is here to explain to us what's going on and why EIP 1559 is such a big deal for the crypto community. Hi Leah, this has been quite a buzz for a bit now. So what does EIP 1559 do and how does it work?
Thanks, Chris. So EIP 1559, it stands for Ethereum Improvement Protocol 1559. And it's an idea that's been floating around for a couple of years now. Basically, how it works is that EIP 1559 divides the gas fees on Ethereum into two parts. The base fee is what you need to pay to get your transactions included into the next block. The tip is an extra fee that sophisticated Ethereum users can pay to get their transactions ordered in a specific way. The benefit of this new system is that gas fees are predictable. Users always know how much they need to pay to get their transaction included in the next block, a huge improvement over the old version of Ethereum where you had to guess how much to pay. And besides predictable gas fees, the other big change is that EIP 1559 burns the base fee, leaving miners to only collect the tip portion of the transaction fees. Burning the base fee accomplishes several things, but first and foremost is that it's a way for Ethereum investors to benefit when people use the network. The more transactions, the more ETH that gets burnt. This reduces the overall supply of ETH, which should lead to higher prices down the line. Even though EIP 1559 only went live yesterday, according to the website ethburn.info, the network has already burnt more than 4,000 ETH. That's $11 million worth of Ethereum that's gone up in smoke in just one day. Now extrapolate that over a year or 10, and you can see how much of an effect EIP 1559 could have on Ethereum's price. Ethereum investors seem to be taking this quite seriously, and the price is even up 39% in the last 2 weeks. Now, nobody can predict the future of cryptocurrency prices, but with EIP 1559 continuously burning Ethereum supply, it's a fair bet that we could see a new ETH all-time high before the year ends. Back to you, Chris.
Thanks, Leah. We'll be sure to closely watch this and the ETH price. Don't fall out of your seats in shock, but the latest infrastructure bill from the United States deals with a lot more than just bridges and potholes. For example, there's a section about crypto, and while I'd love to tell you that it's good news, well, it's really not. The primary concern is a section of the bill that defines who is and is not a crypto broker. The problem is that the bill uses unnecessarily broad language to classify all sorts of crypto participants as brokers, so that almost anyone can meet the criteria. For example, proof of work miners or proof of stake validators. That's a problem because once someone is classified as a broker, they'll need to submit tax and other legal documents for their clients. So you can see the problem here. How the heck is a miner going to identify his or her clients and then submit tax documents to the United States government? It's a ridiculous proposition that would suggest one of two scenarios. Well, either the government officials who wrote this section of the bill are completely crypto illiterate and have no clue about what they're doing, or they know exactly what they're doing and want to use this bill as a chance to drive crypto out of the United States. For example, if miners can't submit tax documents, they can't do business in the the US. So whether it's ignorance or a planned step in a crypto ban, crypto advocacy groups like CoinCenter and the Electric Frontier Foundation are hard at work trying to get the language of the bill changed. For the latest updates, you can follow Jerry Brito, the executive director of CoinCenter, on Twitter. Let's hope the crypto community is able to come together and get the language of this bill changed before it's too late. The crypto community was thrilled when Gary Gensler was named the head of the SEC. Gensler is well known for teaching a blockchain class at MIT, and many people figured that he would bring favorable regulation to the cryptocurrency industry. Flash forward to today, and it's no longer clear what direction Gensler is going to take the SEC. For example, Gensler recently appeared on CNBC's Squawk Box program, where he made a bunch of remarks about the crypto industry and impending regulation. Here's Gensler in his own words.
Bitcoin and the hundreds of other coins that investors are trading in is a speculative asset class. And if people want to take risk, that's all right. But what we want to do is provide them some of the basic protections against fraud and manipulation. The trading platforms they're on are not currently under a regulatory regime that protects them like they're trading on the New York Stock Exchange. It just isn't.
From there, Gensler went on to opine about Bitcoin's potential. And I quote again.
I'm very pro-innovation. I think it helps the economy grow. I think more people get access to finance and access to good medicine, access to good jobs. I think I wouldn't have gone to MIT. I've been a professor there for 3 years at the intersection of finance and technology among some of the world's remarkable experts at MIT. So I count myself as pro-innovation, but I think that we also need rules of the road. This innovation, Satoshi Nakamoto's innovation, if it's going to meet its potential, needs to come within public policy frameworks.
Now that's an interesting take because according to Gensler, the only way for Bitcoin to flourish is with government regulation. Where is one example of a revolutionary new technology that only succeeded because regulators came up with some new rules? Well, if you know, please let us know in the comments below. Now, Bitcoin doesn't need government regulation to flourish. At this point, it's hard to say exactly what Gary Gensler stands for, but he also seems keen on introducing new rules that could restrict crypto innovation in the United States. So we'll be keeping a close eye on this and let you know as we hear more about Gensler's future plans for crypto. And now for a bit of news that's near and dear to my heart. T0, a leader in blockchain innovation liquidity for digital assets, announced this week that it has begun onboarding Exodus investors into its online trading platform for investors seeking to purchase or resell the Exodus Class A common stock. Now, this is very exciting news indeed, and we will keep you up to date on the progress. You can open your Exodus wallet and visit the Shares app to register with T0. Thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you back here next Friday with the latest news updates. Make sure to hit those like and subscribe buttons, and until next time, hold on.